I hope. So, 1 minute. So first of all, we start with the introduction of inflammatory bowel diseases. As you well know, are chronic and relapsing inflammatory condition of the gastrointestinal tract. Okay, now it's coming. But those include Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Both diseases are caused by dysregulation of the immune system that maintains well known that the immune system maintains the homeostasis of the intestinal epithelium and of pathogenic gut flora. They are characterized mainly by an inflammatory process which destroys the mucosa, and this inflammatory process is unpredictable and results in weight loss, diarrhea, abdominal pain, and fever. The two diseases affect different tracts of the mucosa. So you see ulcerative colitis affects the mucosa of the colon and rectum, while Crohn's disease affects any segment of the gastrointestinal tract. Apparently, the two diseases are not are different even in gene expression, of course, because specific mutation characterize colitis and specific mutation characterize Crohn's disease. But there are mutations in gene, a set of genes which are common to the two diseases. IBDs are more common in developed country compared to developing country, and they present higher incidence in prevalence in North America and Europe. The precise etiology of IBD is still unclear, and there are several factors have been recognized that contribute to IBD development. Of course, as I said before, a set of genes can predict or can predispose patients to develop the disease. So 12 genes have been recognized common between CD and UC, and a set of genes that are different between the two diseases. But those genetic alterations are associated to host immune system and other environmental factors. So there are a number of other situations in which that concur to the development of this disease. And for such a reason, it's difficult to utilize and to predict a right therapy and the outcome of the various pharmacological treatment. So the new frontier of IBD treatment are represented by biological drugs. Among those, infliximab is one of the most utilized. It's a chimeric monoclonal antibody directed against the tumor necrosis factor alpha. So tumor necrosis factor alpha is produced by our body as response to infection. So tumor necrosis factor alpha fight infection by causing a transient inflammation in affected areas. Unfortunately, in the case of IBD, we observe an overproduction of TNF alpha, and this overproduction maintain inflammation, and so it is supposed to be responsible for the chronic inflammation found in IBDs. So the idea to counteract by infliximab the overproduction of TNF-alpha is behind this treatment. So the key action attributed to TNF-alpha are, first of all, an increased inflammation due to the production of pro-inflammatory cytokines and chemokines. Then we have an increased infiltration due to the overproduction of adhesion molecules, increased acute phase response that can be detected also in serum, a large tissue remodeling which involves the downregulation of collagen production and overproduction of metalloproteinase synthesis, and then a compromised barrier function in which we observe increment on ion transport and permeability. So, which are the in the outcome of the infliximab treatment? Unfortunately, up to 10 to 30% of patients do not respond to this treatment. And nearly 40% of patients lose response over a year. And it's difficult to predict how to manage those patients because usually they are treated with an empiric dose. So clinicians increase the dose without knowing exactly why and if this increment of dose will be really effective. Or the patients are switched to other treatments. So what the aim of the study is to find a biomarker, a specific biomarker, able to predict the anti-TNF outcome. So our study was based on protein and lipid profile of patients of both genders affected by UC and CD and treated with anti-TNF alpha. And the technology that we select to follow up these patients was Maldi mass spectrometry. Why this study? I said before, to provide predictive tool for TNF response, but also to identify those biomarkers that could not open new avenue for the comprehension of the pathophysiological mechanism involved in anti-TNF action. And all this is in the frame of personalized medicine that could improve the income and particularly, I do not know if in the United States, but in Italy, reduce cost because the treatment of those patients is extremely expensive. We select, of course, in this case, you are looking at preliminary study because we want to have a feeling if this kind of approach is good, and now we would like to enlarge our cohort of subjects, of course. But the subjects are men and women affected both by, affected by UC and CD and treated with anti-TNF agents. The patients were selected responder, patients who had a good clinical response, and non-responder patients without good clinical response, not any response. The patients were not treated with the immunosuppressant, and all sera were collected before infusion. So we start before infusion, so we have the background of the patient, and then we follow the patient up to fourth infusion. So that it's the time of following is nearly 30 weeks. So the number of the patients are indicated here, and the specimen that I utilize is serum. The technology, as I said, is mass spectrometry MALDI profile. This is a panel of the experimental setup. So the sample is drawn and let to clot. The serum is isolated. Then serum is fractionated, since you know that serum contain the 90% of the protein present in a serum are the most abundant protein, the 14 most abundant protein. And so only the 10% of the protein the contained in a serum are the low abundant and signaling protein. So we would like to investigate this fraction of proteins, and so we separate the most abundant from the high abundant utilizing a specific column which bounds 14 protein and 14 antibodies against the 14 most abundant protein, really well standardized, produced by Sigma, and after HPLC we isolate the peak containing the low abundant protein. Then we analyze them by MALDI mass spectrometry, which is a technology that utilizes laser to ionize protein after those proteins have been covered by a matrix that protect them from being burned by the laser. And so the MALDI mass spectrometry provide a really simple spectra and ionize intact protein. And so another limitation of this study, but we choose this technology because we want to restrict the proteome that you want to analyze. You want to the small, low abundant protein and the small protein. So the MALDI mass spectrometry can detect protein till 30 daltons, so not large protein. So we would like to small protein and small peptide that we believe that can be signals and released by the mucosa in response to the TNF effect or in presence of disease. Then spectra acquired are analyzed by dedicated software. Statistics is very important in this case. And the best separating peak that differentiate different conditions are identified. Those best separation peak represents a profile, specific profile of this patient, of a patient. So this is a slide that show you why we want to eliminate the most abundant protein, since we have in this part, so the entire dynamic range of the serum is 9 order of magnitudes. That means we go from milligram to femtomole. So, and we know that even the most sensible spectrometer can detect just over 2 orders of magnitude. If we have in our sample a huge amount of protein which are extremely abundant, our spectrometer will detect only the most abundant protein, and we lose the most important part of the protein, which is the signaling usually are signaling protein like chemokine and so on and so forth. And here, what we did, we choose this column that was is produced by Sigma that is able to bind selectively all these proteins and leave the low abundant protein in our sample. So the experimental design was the first of all the comparison between male and female. Because, of course, as is expected, we cannot mix the two genders, because the two genders in serum, certainly they have differences. So we analyze the two genders separately, being sure that we have a different so-called profile, so best separating peak that differentiate between the two. Then the second analysis is made on... we did the comparison between UC and CD in both in men and women, and try to define which are the best separating peak if there are differences between UC and CD in sera, because this is another issue of IBDs, is the diagnosis is quite difficult. Sometimes it's difficult to determine if it's ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease. And then the third comparison is responder versus non-responder after infliximab treatment. We see that again we analyze responder versus non-responder in UC and responder versus non-responder in CD. And the last, to follow this patient, the profile of this patient after in repeated infusion. Since in the third comparison we compare the sample taken before the first infusion and the sample taken before the fourth infusion. So we have the entire, we can compare exactly the treatment. In this case, we compare all infusion to see if we have a possibility to best detect which is the maximal response after the several repeated infusion. In this case, the comparison between male and female were made in these 9 women and 10 men, both UC and CD. And this is all, I don't want to pest you with all these statistics, but believe me, it's very robust and provide these results. Particularly, the principal component analysis show here, you can see that we can group our sample by gender regardless of the disease. So independently of the disease, we can group, so the the female and male should be analyzed in a different way. So they respond differently with different peak. That means you have best separated peak which correspond to a mass value, but those mass value are different between men and women. So that means we cannot utilize in principle the same therapy or the same approach in male and female. Then again, what we analyzed was if there are a specific profile that differentiate ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease, both in men and women. And again, the number I understand are quite restricted, but the results are very robust. And also in this case, we can see, as you can see from this PCA, we have a clear separation between CD and UC, and the profile identify 29 characteristic peak, 14 upregulated and 15 downregulated, which characterize CD compared to UC. So as you can see, those peak represent a specific mass in a spectra and are up or down regulated in the two diseases. So the identification of this peak is crucial and can tell us which kind of protein and peptide are differentially expressed in these two groups of patients. Then the same occur when we compare CD and UC in women, and the same with the same information. As you can see, we have in this case a down-regulated peak in CD, while this up-regulated in UC. So this is a candidate, of course, to the identification, because this peak could be extremely informative for your disease. And then responders versus non-responders with the same strategy. Also in this case, we have a responder versus non-responder in UC, and you can separate really well responder versus non-responder and identify best separating peak which differentiate the two groups. This is true in ulcerative colitis and also in Crohn's disease. But what is interesting is that the responder versus non-responder share a group of peaks, seven peaks, six upregulated and one downregulated. So that means there is a specific profile which is common, like we found in a genetic study, that there is a set of genes which is shared between the two. And also in the case of profiling of low abundant protein and low molecular weight protein, we found a set of mass with protein and peptide which are shared between the two diseases. So again, the last comparison is among repeated infliximab infusion. So there is dose that when you if you want to profile a plasma of patient followed by infliximab, which is the dose that you choose to analyze, because you don't by routine you cannot analyze all the doses. So we found in such a way that the best is to compare the second to the fourth infusion. Between the second and the fourth infusion, you have the maximal response. So in conclusion, we have that men versus women sample can be grouped by gender regardless of the disease, and then protein MALDI profiling is able to provide a serological set of peptide of small protein that are able to discriminate between the two pathologies. Responder versus non-responder, so even in this case we can have a characteristic protein pattern of responder and non-responder, and that could help physician to select or to address patient are the more appropriate therapy. and the comparison between the different infusion tell us that if I want to check the response of a patient, it's better that I test it between the second and the fourth infusion. What we are doing now, this is the most complex aspect of this study, because we are now deeply fractionating this sera, this low abundant fraction, without digesting them, because you know in proteomics usually to identify protein, what to do? You have the low abundant fraction, you digest it, and you analyze by LC-MS. But in such a way, you digested all the peptide, and so you do not know, it's very difficult to then determine which is the right peptide that is increased and upregulated and downregulated, because you reduce a lot your information. So what we do, It's a tough thing, but since we are skilled on separation science due to my background, so we do gel filtration chromatography, and then the gel filtration chromatography, we collect a lot of fraction, and then each fraction is digested and analyzed, and then we reconstitute the profile that we have obtained by Maldi profiling. We were successful in studying prostate cancer in a study in which we analyzed adenocarcinoma in presence of low PCA, or adenocarcinoma in presence of high PCA or intermediate PCA. And we found an extra marker that could help the PCA test, that could be interesting to join to PCA to analyze, to provide a new tool for saying something about cancer predisposition based on PCA level, which we know are not so informative sometimes, because a lot of cancer are lost because we have low PCA and still we have prostate cancer. Together with, I said before introducing my talk, we are joining not only protein and peptide, but we are analyzing not only protein and peptide, but also lipids, because lipidomics is an important issue of the IBDs. Since it's known that sphingolipids and phospholipids play a key role in the modulation of inflammation and immunity, and ceramide and ceramide 1-phosphate is extremely involved in recently technology by Torrette et al. Recently published, in which MALDI profiling is utilized to detect the profiling of glycosphingolipids directly interfacing the separation of HPTLC to mass spectrometry. We utilize this technology. We are now utilizing these our preliminary results, and the high performance delay chromatography, which is the classical technology to analyze lipids. But of course, the sensitivity of this technology is very poor, so you cannot analyze a lot of sample. This analysis was done on serum again. Then from serum, the lipids were extracted in organic and aqueous phase, then are loaded in for the separation in an automatic system that makes the high-performance thin layer chromatography. The thin layer chromatography is then stained by primulin and analyzed by scan densitometry. So we can quantitate, of course, with a proper software dedicated to this quantitation. Or the alternative is to spray directly the HPTLC by matrix, utilizing the image prep, which is a device provided by Bruker, and then put this HPTLC directly into mass spectrometer. Then the lipids covered by the matrix are ionized by the laser, and so we can analyze precisely the entire lane. So here we see just few bands. Analyzed by MALDI mass spectrometry in such a way we can profile starting from that till at the end. And so we can identify huge amount of lipid, glycosphingolipids, which plays really a crucial role in many diseases. This of course, is new. It has never been done on IBDs, and it's not really often done on other disease. And we would like to introduce as a routine, or of course it's not thinkable now to translate this technology, which is quite complex, directly into clinics, but we hope to open the possibility to analyze sphingolipids directly in a biological fluids and provide more information that now are not possible to achieve. Here we have we made a comparison between CD and UC, and we made a comparison between responder and non-responder. As you can see, analyzing directly the HPTLC after staining, we cannot find any statistical significant difference between UC and CD. But we are analyzing just these four species, not more than four species. And again, if we take into account responders versus non-responders in colitis and Crohn disease, in this case, we can identify two species. So the phosphoethanolamine and the phosphatidylcholine, which are differentially expressed, differentially produced in responders versus non-responder in UC. So how manage this data and figure out really the role we have to think about, because really our, a new approach, nobody has written anything about that on this disease. And then responders versus non-responders in CD, this kind of lipids are unchanged. But it's not, the story is now going on by scanning by MALDI mass spectrometry all the lane and analyzing and comparing all the species that can be identified. In such a way, we can identify spectra. As you can see, every place, every space taken by the laser, even here where there is nothing, in staining by mass spectrometry, we can identify molecules. So we are confident that we can produce a set of lipids and molecules that can be informative on the response of TNF treatment. Of course, we expect since ceramide and ceramide 1-phosphate has been recognized as being influenced by TNF, so we would like to have more information about that. And then this is my group. I would like to acknowledge you, of course, for your attention, the proteomic group in Milano, in my lab, the clinical unit at the San Donato Hospital, and of course, fundings for supporting this research. Thank you very much for your attention. So I know that there are a lot of points that clinically can be discussed, because the number of samples, but it's a preliminary study, but I hope, really I believe on that. I think it's a field that should be followed together, of course, with genomics, because we cannot forget it.
Thank you. This interesting paper is open for discussion.
This is fantastic work. I'm not a proteomicist, my questions may be naive. I have two questions. One is a clarification. The peaks that you see are not peptides, they're whole proteins?
The peaks that I see are or peptides, that means short peptides, or small proteins. So.
But your aim is to actually get peaks from whole proteins.
In this case, but what I mean is, even if and they are peptides. That means they are made by different amino acids and not cut by at the trypsin level. Because when you digest and treat with LCMS, you digest and you cut the peptide at the trypsin level. Here is not the trypsin level. It's the
I understand. So do you know what protein corresponds to what peak, or are you just looking at peaks?
In this, what I presented here is just look at peak. We are now looking for the, our goal is to identify, of course, all these peaks.
And my other question was about the principal component analysis. These separations look fantastic.
Yes.
But if you were looking at two variables separated like this, the p-value would be minuscule.
Yeah.
But when you do principal component analysis, you can choose and peak. The ultimate aim of my question is, do you have a handle on the statistical significance of the separation? Because as you mentioned, your sample size is pretty small.
Yes, but we analyze the entire spectra. So the principal component analysis is made analyzing, comparing the entire spectra.
Yes, I understand this, but what I'm saying
is... We didn't
is
select...
Because you have all this selection, out of a very large number of peaks...
But we didn't do any change or selection, particular selection, because it was out of our interest.
No, you didn't, but the algorithm does the principal components.
Yes, of course, but we need to implement a number of samples. It's for such a reason that we ask to other hospitals, because in Italy, we do not have a lot of patients treated with infliximab. So it's difficult to, one of the difficulties that we have is to have blood to analyze from patients treated. And so, two, because the right number is at least 30. Those are ridiculous numbers. So we want to implement, which is really, now we have understood, and so it's really easy to analyze 30 sample, 50 sample. But now the time required for collecting is the only limitation that we have. So if somebody has sample, blood sample, we are open.
Thank you. I think it's a naive question, but for this non-respondent patient,
non-responder,
did you check the expression of TNF?
No, we didn't check the expression of TNF in this case.
Because, I mean, for me it would be the first...
Yes, me too, but when I asked the clinician, they didn't check. They just gave us what they have. Of course, the first thing that we'll do is to check the expression of TNF directly, because so we know in advance if those TNF is expressed or not. Otherwise, they do not respond because they do not have any TNF.
Okay, a second question, I think it's naive as well. It's why did you choose the serum and not the cell?
Because not the cell means the biopsies.
Yeah, or any other source of cells.
The serum is easy. Because you in proteomics, you don't have the possibility of amplification. So if you choose the circulating cell, you have a little material. So if you choose biopsy, of course, it's the right system. But biopsy, you have a lot of cells. And... also, biopsy are not easy to obtain. So if you want to propose something that could be easy to perform, serum. So if we made an effort, it should be made for something that can be applied. Otherwise...
Thank you.
Any other questions? Yes, in the back.
I have two questions, and the first one is for identification. And as you said, that you didn't use the enzyme, but you can take the de novo type sequencing approach for identification. Have you ever tried?
Unfortunately, I didn't try.
Mm-hmm. But if there's some partially sequence could be properly read,
yes.
De novo can be.
Yeah.
And then another question is for TNF, whether the TNF is detectable in your system. So if you input the TNF in your sample, whether
yes,
some
the same system that we have utilized for PSA. Mm-hmm. It's the same. Unfortunately, this is preliminary, and the idea is that to put TNF into our system and then refer to TNF. Mm-hmm.